Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. If things look different on the set today, they are. Nick Wilkie was going to be our co-host, but he's out on medical leave, and we wish his return very soon. We miss him very much, and he's a great co-host. And so, Nick, a shout-out to from Disability Viewpoints and the team. Get better soon. Look forward to having you back. And Katrina Simons was our first guest today. She works for the ICI at the University of Minnesota and does many great things in the community. So it was nice to catch up with her again. And then Gene Martinez will be our second guest and talk about voting and all the good things that are coming up for the state of Minnesota. So we hope you'll stay tuned to Disability Viewpoints as we open up another show here in about 2 minutes on SPNN. Please stay tuned. Thank you. Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. This mask on me isn't for Halloween. It's just precautionary. I'm a little under the weather, so I don't want to spread it to anybody here in the studio. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. Our guest host today was supposed to be Nick Wilkie from the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. He is out ill, and we wait for his return fairly soon and hope he gets well soon also. But with me today is Katrina Simon, and she works for the ICI at the University of Minnesota, and she's got a plethora of things she wants to talk to us today about, so I thought I'd let her introduce herself and tell us a little bit about her. And if the name Simons is familiar, it should be synonymous with the show. Her sister, Ani Simons, did the legislative report for a lot of years here on Disability Viewpoints. So this is her sister, and we welcome her. Welcome on board. Nice to have you. Tell us a little about yourself first, Katrina, and welcome to the show.
Hi. Thanks, Mark. Well, my name is Katrina Simons, and I'm a native Twin Cityer, so I grew up here. And I work for the University of Minnesota Institute on Community Integration. And what we do is we work at having people with intellectual and developmental disabilities be fully included in all aspects of their life. And my role in that, there's a whole bunch of projects that the Institute has, but my role in that is to, I'm the community program specialist and the self-advocacy action committee coordinator. So I try to find ways to get people living with intellectual and developmental disabilities as involved in the legislative and policy process as they want to be / can be in our state. So that's what I do.
Are you recruiting quite a few people then?
We have 14 people on our committee, mm-hmm. and we're not really looking for any more committee members at the minute. But what we are doing is always looking for people who want to be involved in focus groups and studies and things like that.
So what does it take to be on your committee? What are the prerequisites?
Well, okay, so to be on the committee, it's kind of by invitation, mm-hmm. and we have you come and you come to a meeting and you see if you like it and you see if it's a good fit, and then we talk about members. But anybody really can be involved in or can be involved in our focus groups.
So what does the committee accomplish? What does it do? It meets monthly then?
So our committee meets monthly, and what we do is we vet the work that we do at the ICI. So right now we have a number of studies on transition and a couple studies on retirement. So we might ask you, when you transitioned from high school to whatever you did after high school. So some people went to college, some people went to a job, some people went to some post-secondary training. We ask you what that was like, and then we ask you if you had enough decision-making support in where you went after high
school. Sounds great. So your job again is, and what do you do there?
So I'm the coordinator. So I'm the person you'll be talking to if you want to be on a focus group or something, or if you want to connect with ICI.
Right, great. Yeah. Now, how long have you done that?
I've been doing that I've been there for like 8 years, but for the first two, I was still getting acquainted. So I've been doing that for about 6 years.
Great, good for you.
And I really like it. And it's me and my friend John Smith.
Yeah, good for you.
Yeah. And then me and Nick are doing the Boldly podcast. So we're excited for when he can get well and he can come back and
right.
and finish that up.
We're excited to get him back here too.
Yeah, we're pretty get better soon, Nick. We're pretty pumped for when you come back.
Yeah, that's right. We're missing you.
Yeah.
What type of education did you get the job that you have?
Okay, so I actually only have a bachelor's.
Okay.
But then I have a fellowship after that in NDD and IDD, which is neurodevelopmental disabilities right. and intellectual and developmental disabilities. I worked at a camp when I was 17. Or I went to the camp from the time I was 8 to the time I was 15, and then I worked there from when I was 15, 16, and 17.
I knew you were smart like your sister.
And I just really decided that was what I wanted to do, and I've enjoyed it ever since.
Right. And so you did attend the University of Minnesota then?
I did not. I went to the University of Wisconsin-Whitewater in okay. Wisconsin, and then I did a fellowship here at the University of Minnesota.
Good for you. How did the fellowship go? Did you like it?
I liked it a lot, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was called the LEND Fellowship, the Leadership, Education, and Neurodevelopmental mm-hmm. Disability mm-hmm. Fellowship. It was a great fellowship, and the applications to apply come out in February. So if anybody wants to apply to be a Minnesota LEND Fellow,
February
those applications are coming out in February, and we'd like everybody to apply because we have a number of community fellows. I think, so ICI is something called the USED, which is a University Center for Excellence in Developmental Disability. Mm-hmm. And I think of all the USEDs with the LEND programs, with the fellowship program, I think we're the one with the most community fellows. So we take the highest number of people that have lived experience with disabilities of anywhere else in the country, and I think that's pretty
cool. So two questions all at once. What type of education did you get to do all this? And if somebody at home is watching and wants to do what you have accomplished and do every day, what would you recommend?
So I have a bachelor's in psych. That's all I have, a bachelor's in psychology. I had minors in special ed and social work, but to be honest, I don't think that the particular area of study even really matters. I just think that if you want to have a job like the one that I have, you just need to take as many courses as you can about working with people and, yeah. I don't know. I think my counseling courses are pretty helpful because I meet a lot of people in my line of work.
Well, you do. You have a network then.
Yeah.
So in the time we have, what else do you want to talk to about today? What else do you want to tell the people at home?
Well, so I wore my Halloween shirt.
Inclusion?
Because it says inclusion. Okay, if you can't see it because I don't know where the cameras are, and also some people have visual disabilities, so it says inclusion isn't scary, and it has a little witch in a wheelchair with a communication device. And then it has a little skeleton with crutches. And then it has a little mummy with a cane. And then it has a ghost with an AAC device.
So you're all set for Halloween.
So I just wanted to say happy Halloween to everybody.
There you go.
And watch out for those teal pumpkins.
There you go.
And if they're teal, remember the person has a food allergy, so maybe don't bring the candy out. Maybe bring some pencils or something like that.
There you go.
I'm just also very excited about, did you guys see the article on it wasn't an article because it was on NPR.
Right.
The story on NPR about Tabitha Haley.
No.
And she was working as a... She has spinal muscular atrophy, uh-huh. which is a disability that it's a muscle wasting disorder, so it's a mobility impairment, but it also impacts your lungs and your joints and pretty much every aspect of your physical body. So you do need a high level of support.
Great.
When you live with that disorder. Anyway, and she lives with that disorder, and she's a senior vice president at Chase Morgan Bank.
Wow.
And she had been on Medicare and medical assistance, or whatever the version of medical assistance is in New York. They didn't say the name of it in the article. Since 2006, and she recently was, unfortunately, that she was kicked off that program.
Why is that?
And they don't know why. So she's in the process of appealing that and everything, but I'm hoping that this leads to progress in Social Security reform, which is something that a lot of people in the disability community have been
Tell me what's your take on Social Security reform?
I just think we need to update the guidelines. You know, so the max amount you can make each month without it affecting your benefits is $63.01. And that was made in 1982, and that's just not feasible anymore.
That's a while ago.
That's not, yeah. So I'm hoping that this story brings attention to the need for Social Security reform, and I'm really hoping that Tabitha's able to find why she was dropped from
the
program.
Well, she's got a pretty good backing with Chase Bank, so I'm sure.
I mean, hopefully. She did have to take a leave.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. So we got about a minute, 30 seconds left. Is there anything else you want to say before I go to break?
Just thank you so much for having me. And everybody who wants to work should be able to. And we need to keep fighting for that at both the state and the federal level. And thank you for having me. And we hope you feel better soon, Nick. Love to have you back.
Yeah, well, very good. And thank you for being here today. Say hi to your sister, Ani. And also, when the session starts in January 2025, are you going to join us and advocate down there at the House and Senate?
Yeah, you know, I haven't been actually down to the Capitol since 2022.
Yep.
So I'm pretty pumped to get back there because the pandemic really made it difficult to be there in person.
Well, there's a lot of remodeling going on now in the state office building, but I think your story about Social Security reform and disability people wanting to work needs to be heard again. We can't say that enough times. So I hope you'll join us.
So I hope to be I hope to be there in person this year was all I was going to say.
Well, great. Well, thank you for being on here.
Thank you for having
me. Katrina Simons, and of course that name is synonymous with Ani Simons and the disability community. They're two sisters that have done really great things for the disabled community, and we can't thank them enough. Katrina, thanks for being on here, and we'll be back with Gene Martinez and more of Disability Viewpoints in just a moment. Please stay tuned. Hi, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. At this point of the show, we now have Gene Martinez. He's a familiar face on the show over the last 26 years. He's done a lot of great things for the disability community. Welcome back, Gene.
Thank you.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're at now and where you're working and what you're doing and all those good things.
Yeah, I have been with the ARC Minnesota since 1990. Well, I was with some of the, started out with the state organization and then the local organizations, but we all merged back into the ARC Minnesota in 2018. And I'm the legislative advocacy coordinator. So we have a registered lobbyist, Tina Rusi, who's our public policy director, but I focus more on the grassroots side, and we have some community groups organized by congressional districts called the Capital Connectors Teams, and then I also coordinate all of our voting engagement activities with multiple organizations through Rev Up MN.
And what does ARC Minnesota stand for?
Well, ARC used to be an acronym. Now we are just the ARC, but it started out using the R word, and so we evolved over time, I think in the late 80s maybe, it just became the ARC. So.
Right. Sounds great. How closely do you work with Steve Simon?
We work very closely with Steve Simon. We have
Who is Secretary of State of Minnesota, by the way.
We have an annual forum with him in July, a Zoom forum with Steve Simon and our Rev Up MN membership to kind of review what's happening with voting laws or any changes or review what happened at the legislative session. And then we also regularly, on an ongoing basis, work with Melanie Hazelip of his office.
Right. Sounds great. So you mentioned a lot of things in there, voting in Rev Up Minnesota. What is Rev Up Minnesota, and how can people get involved in that if they want to?
Yeah, it stands for Register, Educate, Vote, Use Your Power, and Rev Up America was formed by the American Association of People with Disabilities, AAPD, mm-hmm. in 2016. And I noticed in 2018 that there was no Minnesota affiliate, so I received permission to start up Rev Up MN, and we have 26 organizations now that are part of Rev Up MN, provider groups, advocacy groups, people with other nonprofits. So a lot of the participation is through those member agencies, but any individual person who is interested in participating can always be part of those meetings.
Sounds great. Well, our election is right around the corner, so there's a lot of facets to cover when you're in the disabled community as far as voting, the procedure, getting to vote, where your precinct is, where you should go, have they moved the precinct? So there's a lot of unanswered questions. So if we take the word voting, it's about five or six letters, but it's a big word in the community. So where do we begin when we want to go voting on election day or before absentee voting?
Right.
What do you recommend?
Well, there are some excellent fact sheets on the Minnesota Secretary of State's website that review specific things. So, for instance, say you are not registered to vote and you want to vote on you want to register on election day. There's a fact sheet that talks about that. Say you are in a sort of residential facility and you want to use agent delivery to have somebody bring a ballot to you.
Right.
All the rules and regulations are on that fact sheet. Or if you want to vote absentee or early in person, there's also a fact sheet that reviews that information. So. There's plenty of resources there. You can also utilize a state voting guide that AAPD produces for each state, and we'll have a link to that on the Rev Up MN Facebook page.
Great. Okay, say that I cannot drive, and I can choose to ride Metro Mobility. Are there other organizations that I can call and say, hey, I need a ride to the polling place?
Well, that's a great question. Transportation has always been a barrier. I know in some previous elections, the Met Council gave discounted rides.
Right.
I also remember Uber and Lyft doing that too. But I think it's an individual situation. What I would recommend people do is, do you have staff that could give you a ride? Do you have family or friends that could give you a ride? Maybe looking at this, you know, a couple of weeks before the election.
Right. So there's, and not the day before.
Right. So there's still time to vote,
plan that
absentee
out. Yeah.
And all that if you absolutely have to. But
yeah, the early voting we know has done pretty well in the state. And
yes,
you could vote absentee at the same very same time that took effect.
Right.
And that's gone very well too. So. Mm-hmm. So as far as voting, what do you oversee there at ARCA Minnesota?
Well, our voter engagement work, we have some grant money that we got from AAPD, and it helps us fund activities around the state. So right now we are... we've had groups in Mankato, Rochester, St. Cloud, Duluth, and Plymouth, and also Richfield and St. Paul coming up, that have organized events for their area. In some cases, it's been voter education forums in some cases. They've combined that with candidate forums or candidate fairs. So there's been a variety of activities that each region has figured out what would work best for their community.
Right, great. So if any organization is looking to think about, you know, our election day, what would you recommend in all the years you've dealt and stuff like this? What's the one piece of advice you'd like to tell people?
Well, I would say, organize your communication to voters. Be thinking about that right now. What are you going to do every day before the election to remind people about the various things related to the election? We always recommend that people come up with an individual plan on how they're going to vote that covers transportation and all of those other things, looking at a sample ballot so you can kind of make your choices who you want to vote for, or do research around the candidates, or if there's like a constitutional amendment or something like that. So just to publicize that information, preparing people, whether they're going to be voting at the polling stations and want to use one of the ballot marking machines, or if they want to vote in person at maybe their city hall, or if they still want to get an absentee ballot and do it by mail like I did yesterday, mailed in my absentee ballot. So we have so many different ways you can vote in Minnesota. So it's just kind of coming up with the best way for the individual person.
And there is a lot of people voting by absentee ballot now.
There sure is.
Ahead of time. That's great. So in all the years that you've been involved in this, 1990 or the 80s, what's the one thing that is stands out in your mind or you'd like to see done different?
Well, there have been efforts in the past. Luckily, they have not been successful, but to require a photo ID before you can vote. Right. And there's so many people with disabilities who might not have a current photo ID for any number of reasons.
Thank you.
And chances of somebody trying to impersonate another person and vote. I just heard Secretary Simon the other day say that, over a 10-year period, there were maybe 14 cases of potential fraud, and they caught all the people that were involved. So it's really not an issue of people impersonating other people. So that I'm glad that we have defeated that.
I'm sure it's an issue, though.
It's an issue that people still bring up. Right. And, of course, it's just this general lack of faith in our election system that we've seen over the past few years. But I think we have some of the most very honest voting system in Minnesota.
Absolutely, I totally agree. So this is the third governor, really, that's been tapped for vice president of the United States in Minnesota. McCarthy in the 60s, Mondale in 1977 about, and now Governor Walz. It's a big honor for the state of Minnesota, and I think it's a great thing. However, how close do you think Minnesota and Washington, D.C. really work on voting issue like this and voting things?
Well, we have strong support for voting rights. Congress they passed in the Senate the John Lewis Voting Rights Act, but because of the filibuster, they were not able to, pass that. But when the Democrats had control of the House, they passed the John Lewis Voting Rights Act. There's strong support from you know, Senator Klobuchar and various members of our congressional district. So yeah, there is strong support at the federal level for expansion of the protection of the right to vote. But you know, just because of our the filibuster and other things, we haven't seen that pass yet.
Okay, we're down to about a minute and 30 seconds. It's what I call the final word segment. Is there anything we might have missed that you want to say before we go to break?
Well, I just want people to, you know, ponder a little bit, you know, why is voting for people with disabilities even necessary? People might say, ah, my vote doesn't have an impact. But it really does, because there are so many decisions at the local level, at the county level, state level, and federal level that directly impact your right, your rights, and your quality of life, whether that be healthcare or housing or transportation. So it's very important to care about those issues, to express your opinion by voting, and to increase or continue the increase in voting by people with disabilities that we saw in 2018, 2020, and 2022. So we want to just, you know, continue that upward trend and not lose ground.
As I think I can sum it up this way, as we are part of the buying public, you know, we buy houses, we buy cars, we buy groceries, everything the normal public does. We have a say in our quality of life, as you said, and our benefit programs. So that's why in a budget year like what's coming up in January 2025, we go down there and express our opinion, our voice, so that we can up our quality of life by the type of funds that are spread for our benefits. And I think it's that simple. And as it is important for you to get out and vote, and please get a hold of the ARC of Minnesota if you have any questions. There you can look up their website, and you can contact Gene Martinez at the office, not at home, but I'm sure he'd be glad to help you. Gene is a great guy and a good friend of the show. Been out here many times. We'd like to thank him at this point for being on Disability Viewpoints. Hope he'll stop back again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gene, for being on. We'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints right after this. Stay tuned, please. Well, thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints today, and we wish that Nick Wilkie would get back in here soon and hope he's starting to feel a little bit better. We miss him on here and look for his return to Disability Viewpoints very soon. Gene Martinez gave us a lot of good information and insight on voting in Minnesota and the good works that ARC is doing and their close relationship with the state of Minnesota and Washington, D.C. Katrina Simons did her usual magnificent job. If the name Simons is synonymous with the show, it is, because her sister Ani did the legislative update here for years, and we miss her very much, but we see her from time to time. But Katrina works for the ICI at the University of Minnesota, so if you'd like to contact her, you can. She does a lot of good advocacy for the disabled community, and it was a joy to have her on the show. So we hope you'll join us again next time for another edition of Disability Viewpoints. For the whole entire team at SPNN, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you very soon. Bye for now.